found a bare feet and stripped of their garments fairly laid, bleeding from where they were weaned. Oh, around midnight, all began to pray, and silently started to sing. The earth shook about, their swirls of light, and you went all out, and you went called out to be a servant, called out to be a servant, called out to lift the standard, called out to raise the banner, you went called out to be a painter, called out, called out from this world. Prison walls on that day, the jailer found a bare feet and stripped of their garments fairly laid, bleeding from where they were beaten. But all around midnight, all began to break, and silently started to sing. The earth is about to open up and wide, God said, you may call.
For a purpose. You have a purpose. God didn't make no mistake when we started calling you by name, calling to draw you to the cross. He didn't make no mistake because he knew that you've been called to be a witness. You've been called to raise up and lift up a standard and a banner for the Lord Jesus Christ. We've been called to show forgiveness. For this day, 2020, God shows us. He called us out.
That's right.
That we may be missionaries, that we may be ministers, that we may be a witness. We can be a caregiver. We've been called out.
That's right.
Why don't we answer the call tonight? Whatever it may be, just say, Lord, I'm giving it to you. I give my heart, my life, and all to you. You call me, I'm responding. Listen to this second verse.
Silence, he started to sing. The earth shook about.
Lord.
Hallelujah. Guess what?
What?
I'm your new song director.
Yay.
We're going to take the church hymnal. Have you ever sung out of the church hymnal?
Yes.
Let's go to page 92. I don't know if you're going to need the book or not. Some people say, I do more for God. Well, when we get to praying, we're motivated to do more for God.
Yes,
I got to talking to Dustin the other day, and it seems like that we get talking about the things of the Lord. And I asked him, I said, which one do you think is going to do more for God? Man that sits there and prays all the time about doing it, or a man that prays and starts doing it? He said, well, the man that starts doing it. I said, absolutely. We got a lot of people that's been praying for 30 years.
Yes,
amen.
That's right.
Amen.
I think it's time that we get out of the boat.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
We've been called out for a purpose.
That's right.
I started thinking on that second verse where that he said that it was in that prison walls. I'm saying, God, break us loose.
Yes.
Take us out of the prison walls. Those walls that have confined us for so long, God, break us out. Break us out, God. We need to break out, don't we?
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Just a little talk with Jesus is going to make it all right.
I once was lost in sin, but Jesus took me in. Jesus made me whole. Had a little talk with Jesus.
Thank you.
To the nights that we were permitted to stay with my little granny. That's what I always call her, little granny. Little Cherokee Indian woman. Loved God and loved to pray. Went to sleep many, many nights listening to her ring the prayer bells of heaven. Amen. She would give such a peace in the house through her prayers. And then she'd wake you up in the morning with a smell of bacon and eggs cooking. Made you think that you just went to heaven overnight. Hallelujah. I tell you, prayer still works, church. Prayer still works. It's time for us to worship the Lord tonight through our offerings and our tithes. And I just ask you tonight just to be obedient unto God. God knows the needs of the church. God knows what we have need of way before that we ever pray. And if we will pray, God will supply the need. God will supply the need. How many of you know that God will supply the need?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. And sometimes it is acts of faith that we go through, and we do, to see the miraculous hand of God move. And so you be obedient unto God tonight. And he said that if we will obey him, that's better than sacrifice. And God responds to obedience. So you just obey the Lord tonight. Hallelujah. Brother Simmons, will you pray for us?
Father God, we love you. We thank you for this day that you've given us to worship you. God, ask your blessings upon this congregation, each and every one that's here, God. Let the Spirit of God touch us, Lord, I pray. God, you know the very needs of God's people tonight. And Lord, those in the rest homes or wherever they may be, God, I pray, God, that you would touch them tonight. God, heal their bodies for the glory of God. Lord, we praise you, God, for what you do for us. Every day, God, you go with us and walk with us, God. And I'm so thankful. Lord, bless the offering. Use it for your glory and honor. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Tonight, immediately following the service, we need to have a men's meeting in the fellowship hall. So, brother, please do your best to be there with us. Sister Diane is having her class, teen class party. It's going to be at your house on the 8th, which is this coming Saturday. So all of you teenagers, make sure that if you do not already have all the details, I'm sure in Sunday school she's already been filling you in on it. So, and also the 14th, I am excited about this. It's a vintage Valentine's Day banquet. And it's you need to look at the flyer. There's an insert in the bulletin, but there's some on the outside. And I encourage you to bring people with you. or invite your neighbors to come. This is a good way to get them acquainted with people in your church. And so utilize that time. The 22nd is the yard sale. And for more details on that, please see Sister Diane. Sounds like Sister Diane's going to be busy this month, don't it? But we are really trying to raise money to help send our youth to camps, to the Wimama camp and also to the PYFC camp. And believe it or not, it's going to be here on us. Can you believe that we're already into the month of February of 2020? Seemed like that January just started. But also the 29th from 11 to 1, there's going to be a ladies' luncheon that's going to be in the fellowship hall. And ladies, come on out. Revival is going to start on the 1st with Brother Terry Boland. And I want God to really move. And brethren, please hear me. I may say more to you about this tonight in our men's meeting. But we're going to have a men's fellowship on the 13th. That is a Friday evening at 6. And we're going to be having food. We're going to be having fellowship. We're going to have ourselves a good time. So please do your best to come and to be with us on that time. If you love the Lord, you've got to love one another.
Amen.
Yeah. Amen. So I want you to look around and see if there's anybody that you don't love.
I love everybody.
You're in trouble. Right? Because if you see somebody that you don't love, you need to get up and go to them and say, look, we need to get things worked out.
Yes.
Here's a good place for that because, hey, everybody can get you in the altars and we can pray both of you through to your loved
one. That's your fault. One, two,
hallelujah. God's good to us, isn't he? Amen. And I thank God for the love and the unity, the fellowship that we have amongst the people of our church. Sister Taylor's coming to sing for us at this time. And let's worship the Lord with her.
You are healed, I am the Lord.
Signed it with his own blood, didn't he? Amen. Saying, I love you. Thank you, musicians. praise God for our group of musicians that we have. We're so blessed. We're so blessed. Tonight I'm going to ask you to go with me to the book of St. Matthew, chapter 7. And we're going to take a look into God's Word. This is actually last part of the Sermon on the Mount. It's where that we're going to start from tonight. But this is what I feel like God would have me to share with you. Past two Wednesday nights, we have gone over how that the Word of God is compelling us to minister to the needs. It's all right if you'll go ahead and stand. Come on, stand up with me. And tonight, I'm just going to take you back into the Word of God. If we want to do something for God, let's do it God's way. I'll say that again. If we're going to do something for God, let's do it God's way.
Amen.
Right?
Amen.
There's no need to say that we're doing it for God if we're still trying to do it our way.
Right.
And here's some instructions I feel like God has given unto us. And before I read this text, I do believe with all my heart that there is a ministry for the church, but there's also individual ministries that God is calling you into to do. Thank God for corporate ministries. But we all must be working to fulfill the Great Commission.
Yes.
And you're going to be in touch with individuals that the church will not be. And God can use you to fulfill that Great Commission. In Matthew chapter 7, verse 24, he said, "Therefore, whoever hear these sayings of mine and doeth them, I will liken unto him a wise man which built his house upon a rock." Notice what he said. It's not those just that hear him. It will be those that do his word. And verse 25 said, "The rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew, and beat upon that house, and it fell not, for it was founded upon a rock." Our rock is the Lord Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
"And everyone that heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them not shall be likened unto a foolish man which built his house upon the sand. And the rain descended, the floods came, and the winds blew and beat upon that house, and it fell, and great was the fall of it." Let me take you over to the book of Luke, chapter 14, verses 28 through 30, as another part of the text. "For which of you, intending to build a tower, sitteth not down first and counteth the cost, whether he have sufficient to finish it? Lest haply, after he hath laid the foundation, is not able to finish it, all that behold it begin to mock him, saying, This man began to build and was not able to finish." I want to speak to you tonight on the thought of building God's way. Building God's way. Father, I ask you, Lord, that you would come tonight to touch us. God, I pray for you to bring all of our minds together. God, that it will be upon you, upon your word. And I pray that your word tonight will, Lord, just be like a brand of fire. God, that it'll just be written upon our hearts. God, I want to see this church active. I want to see us as individuals do more for God in 2020 than what we've ever done before in all of our life. But God, help us to see that you will go with us and you will give us the plan. And Father, we'll fail not to give you the praise in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Several years ago, I overheard a little boy that was putting some stuff together, and he's trying to build it. And his little sister come along, and she's going to help him. The little boy looked over at his sister and said, "You need to leave my stuff alone, because I'm building something, and I don't know what it is, but I'll know when I have it finished." That sounds like some folks today, don't it? I'm doing something for God. I don't know what I'm doing, but hopefully I'll know by the end.
Right.
But what would happen if we knew what we were doing for God?
Yeah, right.
What would happen if we had goals? What would happen if we knew that God was leading us and God was going to direct us, that whenever it is finished, it is going to be the fulfillment of God's plan? And I want us to look at the word build. B-U-I-L-D. I want us to look at that word tonight. And if we can take that word, God gives us some steps on how to build for Him. And it's personal steps. Every one of us. I was thinking a while ago, how would you take it. If you went to buy a car and the salesman came out and he told you, I appreciate you coming to the General Motors section of the lot here. And he said, they've got some good cars. He said, but I wouldn't own one. And in fact, I'm telling you that this dealership stinks. I wouldn't buy one from here. They don't have good service. They'll lie to you. They'll get you to sign the contract. And then they'll write their own contract and somebody will come along and sign your name. I want to ask you, would you be there?
No.
What do you think that the salesman ought to do? He needs to quit, don't he? Why? Because he does not believe in the company. He does not believe in his merchandise. And if you're not careful, we get caught up in the same thing. You have to believe in what you're doing. And so B stands for believe. Look at the person next to you and say, you've got to believe in what you're doing. You've got to believe in what you are building. You have to believe in that. The teacher must believe in their class. The teacher must believe that God is going to move in that class. The pastor must believe that God is going to build a church. If we're not believing that, then why? Why are we teaching? Why am I pastoring? If I just thought that San Vicente was going to die and decay and rot away, why would I be here? Why not allow God to send a man in here that believes that there is a hope and there is life and there is a future in this church? I know that a lot of times people are very skeptical about what they're doing for God. They're not totally convinced. Some of them one time may tell you, I've been called to sing. And after you hear them sing, you're wondering if God called them to sing. Come on. Some of them say, I've been called to preach. And then whenever you hear them preach, you're wondering who really called them. But whenever you know that you've been called to do something and you are believing in that and knowing that God is going to equip you, then you can start believing in the building or the calling that God has upon your life. And Romans 10 and 9, I know it goes along for salvation, but I believe it's also strong for this. He said that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart that God had raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the scripture saith, whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed. Right. You have to believe. You've got to believe in Jesus. But you've also got to believe in what you are called to do. You've got to believe in that. If you don't, how are you going to be able to sell anybody else? I'm going to ask you, are you convinced tonight? Are you really believing? Because how can you convince others of something that you're not sure of? Right. How can you convince somebody of something that you really don't believe in yourself?
That's right.
That's right.
Help us, Holy Ghost. My dad was a salesman. I'm telling you, I've seen him sell people on things, and I wondered, how in the world, Dad, did you do that? And for a while, Daddy was selling Shackley. I don't know if any of you can remember Shackley or not, but, man, Daddy would take a handful of those things, and I'm thinking, Daddy, you shouldn't be hungry, and you should live forever. You know, he's taking so much of that. He'd do his protein drinks, and he'd tell people how much better he was feeling, and I thought, Lord, he's already got so much energy, I couldn't keep up with him. He didn't want to walk from the gas pump to the store. He would literally run or jog. He'd get out there and race the grandkids and all of this. So I know that Daddy had energy. And Daddy was a salesman on it. He believed in Shackley. And he wanted me to sell Shackley. I wasn't totally convinced that Shackley can do all the stuff that Daddy was saying that it could do. And it might have done it for other people. But because that he was convinced and he believed in it, he could sell it a lot better than I could. Right? I hope that everybody's following me.
Yep.
Because you have to believe in what you're doing. So I'm telling you, if you feel like God's called you to do something, believe in that calling.
Yeah.
Believe in it. You've got to believe in it. You've got to be able to see the finished product in your mind. Why are you doing this?
Right.
Not just because that I believe in it, but because I believe in the results that it's going to bring.
That's right.
Daddy believed in the results of Shackley. He didn't believe that you could take it one day and be changed forever, but he believed that the more you took it, the more effect that it had upon you. And I can tell you with a lot of that stuff, he was absolutely right. The more that you would take it, the greater effect it had upon your body. And so what you believe in, you have to know that you're not in it for the short term, you're in it for the long term. Jesus Christ is long term. Working for God should be a lifetime experience. You're not just going to get started today and then quit. But you've got to believe in your finished goal. And you've got to believe that finished goal is going to be heaven. You've got to believe that what you are doing is going to help somebody else make it heaven. You've got to believe that what you're doing is the will of God. And because of the will of God, you're looking for God to bless you whenever you get to glory. You've got to believe in it. You've got to believe in what you are doing. And whenever that you go to believing in it, then you're going to have a vision. The Bible said in Proverbs 29 and 18, it said, where there is no vision, the people perish. Where there's no vision, the people perish. And that's true, isn't it? Amen. If I come up here every Sunday and said, church, I believe that our church is dying. Lord, we need some help with the singing. Our teachers are not fit to be teaching. And I just don't have no time to prepare, to study, and get a message together. It won't be long until it don't matter how much you love me or love the church, you're going to be saying, man, there's something wrong.
Yes. Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
But you have to have a vision.
That's right.
You have to have a vision. If you're going to sell your car, sell it like it's going to run for another 100,000 miles. You have to have a vision of where you're going with it. In fact, the Bible teaches us that you need to write out your vision so other people know where you're going. True? You need to write it out. You need to make it plain. If you're working with a group of people, and I know that Brother Will, he's worked with groups before, but it would not do him any good to show up at Applebee's and just expect everybody in there to run to their positions unless he had told them what they're supposed to be doing. He did not want a waitress in there over the stove. Now, she might have been able to cook better than the chef, but that was not her place.
Right.
He wanted everything to be set in order.
That's right.
Help us, Holy Ghost. He didn't want a known thief that's still on probation handling the cash register. It was his job to make sure everybody knew where they were expected to be, doing what they were expected to be doing. So your vision, if you want people to get in with it, you need to learn how to communicate that vision. You've got to believe in it, though. You've got to believe in it. If I come here and say, well, I believe that God is just going to make this church grow. And you're thinking, you don't act like you really believe that.
Right.
You've got to believe in your vision.
That's right.
You've got to. And so here's what that the Lord spoke in Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 2. And the Lord answered me and said, write the vision, make it plain upon tables that he may run that readeth it. For the vision is yet for an appointed time, but at the end it shall speak and not lie. Though it tarry, wait for it, because it will surely come. It will not tarry. The more I read this, the more I believe that God has appointed times in our life.
Yes, amen.
He does. You may say, well, I prayed about it 10 years, but God said, hey, in the 12th year, it's going to happen just like I said.
Amen.
I want you to keep working toward that. You're going to have a breakthrough. It's just like the children of Israel. He told them that there was an expected end. There was an appointed time. At the end of 70 years, he said, I'm going to take you back home. At the end of 70 years, God started putting it in their hearts. And they're saying, I want to go back to Israel. I want to go back to Judah. I want to go back to Jerusalem. And God God started moving up on the king's heart then to send them back home, because God said there is an expected end. There is a designated time. And that's what he's talking about here. The vision God gives unto you, write it down. It's going to come to pass. God has drawn the line in the sand and said, at this time, there is an appointed time, but it's going to happen. You have to believe in not only your vision, but in the fulfillment of your vision. You've got to believe that. You've got to believe that at the end of this, that is going to be greater than when you started. You've got to believe that it's going to lead you to a time of fulfillment, a time of blessings, to a time of seeing the effects of God and God alone. So B, you have to believe. You have to use your talent. You mean I can't have a vision and just sit down and wait for it? No. I don't mean to sound so sharp. But it's kind of like if I told Jane, I said, Jane, I need you to take out the garbage. And he sits on the couch. What are you doing, Jane? Believing the garbage is going to be taken out. You're right. Get up. Use your talent. Get it out of the can and take it out.
Right?
Some of us, you may think, preacher, that's, yes. Some of us have talents. But it's like that we just want to close our eyes and believe that the vision is going to be fulfilled because God said it's going to come to pass.
Right.
Let me tell you, God's word is not going to lie. But if you're not going to use your talent, God's
right.
going to give that vision to somebody else who
Amen.
Will use the talent. And after that, you're going to sit back and wonder, well, God, I thought that you told me that's what you was going to do
right.
for me. And God's going to say, yeah, and I also told you to get up and use what I've given you, but you just sat there.
Right.
So I gave the vision to a person that's willing to work.
That's right.
You have to learn to use your talent. You have to learn to use your tools. If you can sing, you better sing.
Amen.
If you can teach, you better teach. You got to learn to use your tools.
Amen.
What would happen if you asked somebody to come build you a house? The carpenter shows up, has all the tools in his belt, has a truckload of tools, and he's just sitting there. Well, what are you going to do? Well, all the lumber's here. It's not going to go together without you pulling out a saw.
Right.
Without you pulling out some nails. Until you get the hammer out of your little pouch.
Right.
Come on, at least shake your head with me.
Yeah.
You have to use your tools.
Right.
And there's so many different tools. I don't even want to go there tonight. But here's what he said in Matthew chapter 25 and verse 24. And I know I've used this passage of scripture several times here lately. But I may be using it again because we need to get the message. We need it in our heart. Then he which had received the one talent came and said, Lord, I knew thee that thou art a hard man, reaping where thou hast not sown, gathering where thou hast not strawed. So, Lord, I was a good man because I was afraid, and I went and hid the talent in the earth, and lo, there thou hast that is thine. And so the Lord pats him on the back and says, I am so proud of you.
No.
That's not what happened, is it?
No.
The Bible said his Lord answered and said unto him,
I am wicked.
And I don't believe he just looked at him and said, oh, you are a wicked and slothful servant. I believe the Lord looked at him with anger. He said, you're wicked. You're slothful. You knew that I reap where I am not sown, I gather where I am not strong, and you went and buried your talent. Who do you think you are? What are you doing with my talent? And I know I'm exaggerating a little bit there, but I want you to get the point. He said, you should have put it to my money to the exchangers, and at my coming, I should have received my own with usury. Take therefore the talent from him and give it unto him which hath 10 talents. If you're to buy all of the materials to build your house, and you've called the builder in, and you come back out there in 3 days, and everything's still sitting where it's at, he's still sitting there sipping tea and eating crackers, you know what you're going to do? You're not going to be real nice.
That's right.
I don't care how nice you're acting right now. But you're going to tell him, I'm not paying you.
That's right.
That's right.
I'm not a crook. And I can tell you this much, if you're not going to do what I've hired you to do, get off the lot.
Yeah.
We'll get somebody in here that's going to grab some tools off the truck and go to hammering and cutting and doing what they've got to do.
That's right.
My Lord, help us right here. I'm not trying to be mean.
No.
I'm not. But I also want you to understand there's some folks that will not dig the footer. They want to come in when everything's just about done and they say, oh, look what we've done.
Yeah.
You've never met anybody like that.
Yeah.
Look what we've done. No. God's looking for somebody that says, I'll take the shovel and I'll dig the footer. I'll pour the floor. I'll do whatever it takes to get the house up. God's given unto me the talent. He's given unto me the tools. And I'm going to use these things for thy honor and thy glory. In Romans 11:29, he said that the gifts and the callings of God are without repentance. That's what he said. And then whenever that you go back and look at the New Living Translation, he said, for God's gifts and his call can never be withdrawn. That's pretty good. That's pretty good. Whenever God's given unto you something, you use it.
Amen.
Okay? Well, preacher, I just don't feel like it. God didn't ask you if you felt like it.
Right.
So many people today are going on feelings. God's not looking for us to go on feelings.
Right.
He's given unto us something to use, and he is expecting us to use it. So you have to believe, and you have to use. This one is one that sometimes, to be honest with you, I have a rough time with. The letter I says that we need to invite other people into our vision.
Right.
We need to invite other people into our building project. I know it's easier, but it's not the way God planned for us to just take and say, I'll do it. I'll do it all. That's not what God wants us to do. That's the reason why he told Habakkuk, you write the vision down. Let those that will run with it make it plain so other people can read what you're doing. You've got to get them involved. Whenever the tabernacle was being built in the wilderness, Moses didn't stand up there and say, God gave me the plan for the tabernacle. And he said, it's got to be done right. So you all just bring the materials and I'll make sure it's done right because I'm doing all the work. Did you read it that way? No. The Bible said God began to bring them out of the tribes.
Yes.
Skilled people.
Right. Yes.
Skilled people.
Mm-hmm. Right. Amen.
And these skilled people, God began to use them. God used people that knew how to sew real good. He used people that knew how to shape silver and gold really well. And it's the same way with the temple. I know Solomon is given the credit for building the temple, but I doubt very seriously that Solomon put one stone in the temple. Why did they give him the credit? He was the one that oversaw it, but he invited others into the vision. He got others to buy into the vision. And so people are there to work from sun up to sundown because now they are believing what he has shared with them. He said, my dad wanted to build a temple. I have stepped up to the throne and now I can see it clearly as my dad that we need to have a temple where that we can all come together and worship. We realize that this is not a place that God will come and just live in because if God's so big, that the earth is his footstool, how is he going to come and dwell in something that we have made? But everybody began to buy into the vision with him. And there were professional, skilled people that knew how to cut stone. Because Solomon said, we're going to build the house of the Lord and not a sound of the hammer or the chisel is going to be in here. So you're going to cut stones out there, then you're going to bring them up here and they're going to fit perfect. You think Solomon went out there and put a hammer and chisel in his hand?
No.
No. Do you think that he was out there with any part of trying to lift up those heavy stones?
No.
I think that he might have been standing off at a distance saying, good job, boys. Good job. He had people that he had invited in with the vision. You need to get people in with a vision. I need you to come in with my vision. There is a great work that we can do, but we have to be a team. We have to work together on it. In Luke 14:23, the Lord said unto the servant, go out into the highways and the hedges and compel them to come in that my house may be filled. Go out and share with them the reason why they need to come in. Go out and make it compelling till they want to come in. How do you invite people to church? Well, if you don't have no place to go Sunday, you could come and be with me in church. That's not very compelling. Somehow or another, you need to pray and ask God, God put some excitement in me that they'll want to go to church instead of going to the beach. I know some of these kids are saying, you kidding me? Maybe some of your parents are saying the same thing. I don't know, but you need to have something inside of you where it compels people to buy into where you are, even in coming to the house of God. God help us. And Nehemiah chapter 2, verse 17, then said I unto them, you see the distress that we are in, how Jerusalem lieth waste, and the gates thereof are burned with fire. And it sounds like it's just a negative story, isn't it? But then Nehemiah said, Come. Come on, help me. Let's build up the wall of Jerusalem that there be no more reproach. Whenever you look at this next verse with me, here's what he used to motivate. Here's what he used to tell them, we can do this. Because he said, then I told them of the hand of my God which was good upon me, has also the king's words that he has spoken unto me. The king said, I'm going to help you. Tell me what you need. I'm going to help you. People are getting excited now. And so they said, let us rise up and build. So they strengthened their hands for this good work. They bought into the vision that Nehemiah had invited them into. He said, we need to build the walls again. How long had those people lived there and seen the walls crumbled, seen the gates burned, and thought it'll always be that way? It's been there for so long until we're going to die and it's still going to be that way. And then suddenly, here is a man that has a vision of the walls being restored and the gates being replaced. And whenever somebody came in with a vision, they're simply starting to say, we're tired of looking at the burned down gates and the crumbling walls. Let's do something about it. After all, this man said, God's with us. After all, this man said, the king is going to help us. So let's get up and let's get going and let's rebuild the walls. You have to invite people in there with you. Because many people will help you if you'd only ask.
Right.
My wife gets on to me all the time about that. She said, if you just let somebody know.
Yeah. Amen.
And then, look at L. Here's another good one. We not only need to use our talents and our tools, but we need to learn how to work. Right. Just because you put a hammer in the hand of a man does not mean that he knows how to drive nails.
That's right.
In fact, if you're not careful, you'll hit this nail more than what you would the little galvanized nail. Am I right?
That's right.
So just because that a person has a tool does not mean that they are learned to do that.
That's right.
But they can learn to do it.
That's right.
I like watching a lot of these outdoor things, and they've got one where that this family is normally the dad, the daughter, and the son that goes out and helps people that are living off the grid pull everything together. And I really like what the daughter told. It looked like a young teenage girl that is out there, and her mom is a hard worker. And she looked at her and she said, "Do you know how to operate a chainsaw?" Well, no. Okay, that's fine. Because you're going to learn.
Right.
You've got to learn. If you're going to live out here off the grid and you're going to cut down timber and you're going to mill it, you're going to have to learn to do that.
Yeah.
And so there's a teacher there.
That's right.
And sometimes you may be the teacher. Sometimes you may be the student.
That's right.
I think about one man that was supposed to be helping these other preachers do things, and he didn't know. I mean, he didn't know. And finally, the pastor looked at him and said, "Son, you better stick to preaching." He said, "Because you can't do anything else." And the guy looked over at him and he said, "Well, I'm sorry." He said, "But I didn't have a daddy that taught me how to work." Well, the pastor felt kind of bad then. Because there's some people that don't know how to work. Sometimes you have to start instructing them. And you have to teach them. But you have to learn how to work. The Bible says in 2 Thessalonians chapter 3 verse 10, "For even when we were with you, this we commanded you, that if any would not work, neither should he eat." Don't come around the table and say, "Oh, look what we've done," if you've not been working. "For we hear that there are some which walk among you disorderly, working not at all, but are busybodies." How many of you remember the old timers talking about people being busybodies?
Yeah.
Normally, if they called them a busybody, it was not good.
Yeah.
It meant that they were meddling in affairs that they should not be meddling in. They had no business being there. And I said this to a young man, that the Bible said that if you don't work, break your plate.
You don't eat.
I know it says don't eat, but I figured he'd just understand better if I said break your plate.
Right.
He went back and told his mom, and his mama said, "Son, don't worry about that. That's Old Testament stuff." I didn't know Paul was Old Testament. That's 2 Thessalonians. That's Paul.
Paul gets around.
Right?
Yes.
And so the Bible is teaching us that we need to learn to work.
Right.
Some of us need to learn to work together.
Right.
The load is not nearly as heavy whenever you're sharing that load.
Right.
I had a freezer that I needed loaded, and I loaded it. But when I started to unload it, my wife was there. And you know, it's amazing, that freezer was not nearly as heavy.
No.
It was so much easier to manage. How many of you understand what I'm trying to tell you? Sometimes we could get a lot more done with a lot less effort if we invite other people and we begin to teach them to work together. Help us, Lord. And then, the more that you work at something, the better you become. And so, whenever that we start taking care and we start taking pride in our work, then we can accomplish so much more.
Yes.
My mind goes to Sister Savannah's husband, some of the things that he made. And I'm telling you, he took pride in his work.
Beautiful.
And one day Sister Savannah was telling me how many saws that it took, because he would take a piece of tree, whether it's a limb or part of the trunk, and he would begin to cut it down. And then the next thing you know, you had the cutest little jewelry box.
Yes.
Or you had something else that he had made with his hands. He worked at it.
Mm-hmm.
He learned to work. He learned to do what he had to do. And that's what we need to do with the Word of God. 2 Timothy 2:15 says, "Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth." You've got to study. You've got to keep working at it. And then D, once again, do your best.
That's right.
D stands for do your best. We have B, that means believe. You use your talent, use your tools. I, you invite others to come in with you. L, you learn how to work.
That's right.
D is you do your best. Anything that you do for God, do your best.
Right.
Do your best. And Proverbs 18:9, he also that is slothful in his work is brother to him that is great waster. I mean, you notice that people that don't take pride in their work, most of the time they don't care about nothing else, and they just waste it. And then look at Romans chapter 12, verse 10 and 11. He said, be kindly affectionate one to another with brotherly love and honor, preferring one another, not slothful in business, but fervent in spirit, serving the Lord. Do your best. Be excited about working for God. Matthew chapter 6. He's on the Sermon on the Mount and said, lay not up for yourselves treasures upon earth where moth and rust doth corrupt, where thieves break through and steal, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust doth corrupt, and where thieves do not break through and steal. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Do your best.
Yes, right. Amen.
You have a payday that's coming. A payday that is coming. Have you noticed that a lot of people are paid according to their skill? And so if they do shoddy work, they get shoddy pay. But if they do quality work, they get quality pay. And if they increase their quality, then they can increase their pay.
That's right.
Do your best. I know that pride goes before destruction, but we need to take pride in what we're doing for God. Don't be slothful in your business. So, in conclusion tonight, we are going to have to live with what we build. So do your best in building it. Take pride in it. Several years ago, Uncle Wayne told me of a man that he knew. And he had got his son out and told his son he wanted him to help him build a house. And so the son comes up and Dad keeps talking to him. He says, son, you're over this project. He said, but I'm telling you, take great pride in your work. Do your best. Do your best. And the son's out there working away. And his dad would tell him, son, take pride in your work. Do your best. The house is finally complete. It is finished. They have the last doorknob in place. And the dad walks up to him and hands him the keys to the house and said, son, this is your house. Now, if he didn't do his best, who's got to live with it?
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right. I'm telling you and I tonight, if we don't do our best, we have to live with it.
Yeah, that's right.
We have to live with it. So let's do our best. Right. Let's do our best. After all, what we're building is not just for the kingdom of God, but it has our name.
Right. Amen.
It has our fingerprints on it.
Yeah.
So we need to be working for God. So you've got to believe. You've got to use your talents. You've got to use your tools. You've got to invite other people to come on in there with you. You've got to learn how to work. You've got to do your best. Because we're working for God.
Yeah,
we're working for God.
Amen.
Will you stand with me tonight? I want you to bow your heads with me. And I just want you to ask yourself this question tonight. Am I really doing my best for God? Am I building it the way God wants me to build it? Do I really believe in what I'm doing? Am I here just passing time? Do I really believe that Jesus Christ is the Lord and the Savior of all men? Do I really believe that? Why am I to work for God? Do I believe that Jesus is the only way to heaven? Do we really believe that? Ask yourself that question. Am I giving my all to God? Am I giving my all to God? You know, tonight I'm not going to ask you to come to the altars. But right where you're at, as Sister Spratlin begins to play the piano, I want you to begin to talk to God from the depths of your heart. You don't have nobody else listening in. This is in between you and God. You know if you've been doing your best. In fact, you know if you've been doing all that you can do. Or have you been waiting for somebody else to start doing it? right where you're at, I want you to just start praying. And in this prayer, I want you to pray from your heart. Your heart's going to tell the truth. But you got to pray from your heart. Your prayer may start out, Lord, please help me to do my best for you. I've not always done my best, but Lord, from here on out, I want to do my best for you. I want to build God's way. Will you just pray from the depths of your heart? It's all right to pray out loud, Father. We are all coming before you tonight. And Lord, I look at you as the inspector of all inspectors. I look at you tonight, God, as the supervisor of the job. There's nothing that is covered up. There's nothing that is hid. And Lord, you come by and you check on us. Tonight, Lord, as you're checking on us, you're looking in upon our projects. God, help us if we're not doing our best. Help us, God, if we've been slothful and trying to cut corners and not putting our heart into serving you. Help us, dear God, if it's just become an ordeal to even be in the house of God. Help us tonight. God, we need you to touch us. Maybe, dear God, we've lost some excitement. Maybe, dear God, we need to go back and renew the vision. Maybe tonight, Lord, is that night where that we just need the Spirit of God to kindle the fire again with new zeal. God, so many people are tired. They're weary. Lord, the devil is doing everything he can, Lord, to stress us out and to ambush us. And I'm praying tonight, Lord, for victory. I'm praying to God for renewed vision. God, I'm praying that, Lord, there'll be renewed energy where that, Lord, we can start saying again, we can build these walls and we can replace the gates that the devil has burned. And we can make this place to be what God wants it to be because we have the favor of God. We have the favor of God. God, I'm praying for that upon this church. I know, Lord, that you're leading us. I know that you're guiding us. God, I want your favor. I want to work under the favor of God. And I know that as the king has spoken to these prophets and said, you go, you tell them that whatever that you need, they'll take it out of the king's forest. It'll come out of the king's treasure. I have a heavenly Father in heaven that is supplying every need. God, I know that you will supply the need. So God, help me to be that laborer. Help me, God, to be diligent. Help me, God, to do my best. Help me, God, to be zealous. Help me, Lord, to invite others to be part of the vision. Maybe tonight, God, someone needs to buy into a vision because, God, their vision's not yet clear. So, God, if they can help us with ours, then, God, then their vision will become more clear. God, I'm asking you to move upon our church. I pray that our singers will pray for a greater anointing. I pray that our musicians will pray for a greater anointing. Our teachers will pray for a greater anointing. God, the leaders of this church will pray for a greater anointing, a greater vision, a vision that is united by the power of the Spirit of God. God, there's people here tonight, Lord, that have visions of what they can do. Some of them enjoy doing it. God, they've got to get started again. Lord, we're not home yet. I ask you to, God, to move upon our church that we'll all be found faithful unto you. God, as we leave this place tonight, I pray to God that we will be able to go with a renewed vision, God, with renewed hope, and say, God, that we're doing this not for ourselves, but we're doing it for God. Lord, found your favor. We found the zeal of God. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. God bless you tonight.